Welcome back, everybody, to another chapter of A Court of Wings and Ruin, written by Sarah J. Maas, read by yours truly, Freewata, with the exclamation point for the added emphasis. We had finished up chapter 29, and we got a lot of precursor lore directly from Asriel, actually, who was told by Rise. So I'm actually curious of, in a game of telephone, you know, we know that a message will get switched up. You know, communication errors happen all the time. So I wonder how that story actually changes from Rise being told that, from knowing the people out east for like Miriam and Drakan and all that. And this hero Nefel that we haven't heard about till now, that I know of at least off the top of my head. We may have heard her before, but maybe only in a short passing. And I wonder how much of all this is true, how much is this misconstrued. I'm guessing all the events probably did happen, but how did it all occur from the actual people's perspective that were in it? But enough of thinking in the future. We also had gotten some spicy scene. That's really what it was all about, baby. Get a little bit of that quick spice at the end of chapter 29. And let's see if we get a little bit more in chapter 30. I was still sore enough the next day that I had to send word to Cassie and I wasn't training with him or Asriel. A mistake, perhaps, given that both of them showed up at the door to the townhouse within minutes. The former demanding what the hell was wrong with me, the latter bearing a tin of salve to help with the aches in my back. I thanked Asriel for the salve and told Cassian to mind his own business, and then asked him to fly Nesta up to the House of Wind for me, since I certainly couldn't fly her in even for a few feet after winnowing. My sister, it seemed, had found nothing in her books about repairing the wall, and since no one had yet shown her the library, I'd volunteered. Especially since Lucian had left before breakfast for a library across the city to look up anything in regard to fixing the wall, a task I'd been more than willing to hand over. I might have felt guilty for never giving him a proper tour of Alaris, but he seemed eager. More than eager. He seemed to be itching to head into the city on his own. The two Illyrians paused their inspection of me long enough to note my sister's finishing up breakfast. Nesta in a pale gray gown that brought out the steel in her eyes. Elaine in a dusty pink. Both males went a bit still, but Asriel sketched a bow, while Cassian stalked for the dining table, reached right over Nesta's shoulder, and grabbed a muffin from its little basket. "Morning, Nesta," he said around a mouth of blueberry lemon. "Elaine." Nesta's nostrils flared, but Elaine peered up at Cassian, blinking twice.
"He snapped your wings, broke your bones."
I tried to shut out the sound of Cassian's scream, the memory of the spraying blood. Nesta stared at her plate. Elaine, at least, was out of her room, but...
"It'll take more than that to kill me," Cassian said with a smirk that didn't meet his eyes.
Elaine only said to Cassian,
"No, it will not."
Cassian's dark brows narrowed. I dragged a hand over my face before going to Elaine and touching her too bony shoulder. "Can I set you up in the garden? The herbs you planted are coming in nicely."
"I can help her,"
said Asriel, stepping to the table as Elaine silently rose. No shadows at his ear. No darkness wringing his fingers as he extended a hand. Nesta monitored him like a hawk, but kept silent as Elaine took his hand and out they went. Cassian finished the muffin, licking his fingers. I could have sworn Nesta watched the entire thing with a sidelong glance. He grinned at her as if he knew it too.
"Ready for some flying, Ness?"
"Don't call me that."
The wrong thing to say from the way Cassian's eyes lit up. I chose that moment to winnow to the skies above the house, chuckling as wind carried me through the world. Some sisterly payback, I supposed, for Nesta's general attitude. Mercifully, no one saw my slightly better crash landing on the veranda, and by the time Cassian's dark figure appeared in the sky, Nesta's hair bright as bronze in the morning sun. I'd brushed off the dirt and dust from my leathers. My sister's face was wind-flushed as Cassian gently set her down. Then she strode for the glass doors without a single look back.
"You're welcome," Cassian called after her, more than a bite to his voice.
His hands clenched and slackened at his sides, as if he were trying to loosen the feel of her from his palms.
"Thank you," I said to him.
But Cassian didn't bother saying farewell as he launched skyward and vanished into the clouds. The library beneath the house was shadowed, quiet. The doors opened for us the same way they'd opened when Rise and I had first visited. Nesta said nothing, only surveying every stack and alcove and dangling chandelier as I led her down to the level where Clotho had found those books. I showed her the small reading area where I'd been stationed and gestured to the desk. "I know Cassian gets under your skin, but I'm curious too. How do you know what to look for in regard to the wall?"
Nesta ran a finger over the ancient wood desk. "Because I just do."
"How?"
"I don't know. Amarin told me to just see if the information clicks."
And perhaps that frightened her. Intrigued her, but frightened her. And she hadn't told Cassian, not out of spite, because she didn't wish to reveal that vulnerability, that lack of control. I didn't push. Even as I stared at her for a long moment, I didn't know how to broach that subject, how to ask if she was all right, if I could help her. I had never been affectionate with her. I'd never held her, kissed her cheek. I didn't know where to begin. So I just said, "Rise gave me a layout of the stacks. I think there might be more on the cauldron and wall a few levels down. You can wait here or I'll help you look." We followed the sloping path in silence, the rustle of paper and occasional whisper of a priestess's robes along the stone floors that only sounds. I quietly explained to her who the priestesses were, why they were here. I explained that Rise and I planned to offer sanctuary to any humans who could make it to Valaris. She said nothing, quieter and quieter as we descended, that black pit on my right seeming to grow thicker the deeper we went. But we reached a path of stacks that veered into the mountain in a long hall, baylights flickering into life within glass globes along the wall as we passed. Nesta scanned the shelves while we walked, and I read the titles a bit more slowly, still needing a little time to process what was instinct for my sister.
"I didn't know you couldn't really read," Nesta said as she paused before a nondescript section,
noticing the way I silently sounded out the words of a title.
"I didn't know where you were in your lessons when it all happened. I assumed you could read as easily as us."
"Well, I couldn't."
"Why didn't you ask us to teach you?"
I trailed a finger over the neat rows of spines. "Because I doubted you would agree to help."
Nesta stiffened like I'd hit her, coldness blooming in her eyes.
She tugged a book from a shelf. "Amarin said Ryson taught you how to read." My cheeks heated.
"He did." "And there, deep beneath the world, with only darkness for company," I asked,
"why do you push everyone away but Elaine?
Why have you always pushed me away?"
Some emotion guttered in her eyes. Her throat bobbed. Nesta shut her eyes for a moment, breathing in sharply.
"Because."
The words stopped. I felt it at the same moment she did. The ripple and tremor, like some piece of the world shifted, like some off-kilter cord had been plucked. We turned toward the illuminated path that we'd just taken through the stacks, then to the dark far, far beyond. The fey lights along the ceiling began to sputter and die, one by one, closer and closer to us. I only had an Illyrian knife at my side.
"What is that?"
Nesta breathed. "Run," was all I said. I didn't give her a chance to object as I grabbed her by the elbow and sprinted into the stacks ahead. Baylights flickered to life as we passed, only to be devoured by the dark surging for us. Slow. My sister was so damn slow with her dress, her general lack of exercising.
"Rise."
Nothing. If the wards around the prison were thick enough to keep out communication, perhaps the same applied here. A wall approached. With a hall before it, a second slope, left rising, right plunging down. Darkness slithered down from above, but the inky gloom leading deeper, fresh and open. I went faster, I said to her. If we could lead whoever it was deep, perhaps we could cut back, right to the pit. I could winnow. Winnow. I could winnow now. I grabbed for Nesta's arm, right as the darkness behind us paused and two high-faced stepped out of it, both male. One dark-haired, one light, both in gray jackets embroidered with bone-white thread. I knew their coat of arms on the upper right shoulder, knew their dead eyes. Highburn. Highburn was here. I didn't move fast enough as one of them blew out a breath toward us. As that blue Fabane dust sprayed into my eyes, my mouth, and my magic died out. Nessa's gasp told me she felt something similar. But it was on my sister that the two focused as I staggered back. Tears streaming the dust from my eyes. Spitting out the Fabane, I gripped her arm, trying to winnow. Nothing. Behind them, a hooded priestess slumped to the ground. So easy to get into their minds once our master led us through the wards, said one of them, dark-haired male. To make them think we were scholars, we'd planned to come for you, but it seems you found us first. All spoke into my sister. Nesta's face was near white, though her eyes showed no fear. Who are you? The white-haired one smiled broadly as they approached. We're the king's ravens. His far-flying eyes and talons, and we've come to take you back. The king, their master, he'd... Mother above! Was the king here? In Valaris? Rise! I slammed a mental hand into the bond, over and over. Rise! Nothing. Nessa's breath began to come quickly. Swords hung at their sides, two apiece. Their shoulders were broad. Arms wide enough to indicate muscle filled those fine clothes. You're not taking her anywhere, I said, palming my knife. How had the king done it? Arrived here unnoted and fractured our wards. And if he was here in Valaris... I shoved down my terror at the thought, at what he might be doing beyond this library, unseen and hidden. You're an unexpected prize, too, the black-haired one said to me. But your sister... A smile that showed all of his two white teeth. You took something from that cauldron, girl. The king wants it back. That was why the cauldron couldn't shatter the wall. Not because its power was spent, but because Nesta had stolen too much of it. And that, my friends, was the end. Chapter 30. Ooh, Nesta. All right, you know, I was actually about to be like, you know what? Why is Nesta always being such a hater? That was like my first thing going to be coming out of this chapter. You know, like, she be acting too good for people. And you know what? Maybe it is because she's too good. She literally took the powers of the cauldron and now she's too powerful. So I guess maybe pre-powers, I would have said Nesta kind of a bitch. You know, because she did really only care about Elaine, but in a way that was like she cared about herself caring about Elaine. But now that she's super powerful, I think she's allowed to act like that at the same time, you know, because what are they going to do? I can't believe a little bit of Fabane, too. I don't think then, right, that Fabane should really stop her. If she took more powers from the cauldron, then a little bit of a, like, magical root that seemed to have wore off quicker from our homegirl Feyre as well. Like, I don't know. Maybe she'll be able to swing back some of that cauldron power on them and take them out. But we'll leave that for the next chapter. So y'all, make sure to stay beautiful, stay hydrated, and we will see you in that next chapter.